Okay, we'll get started. We were discussing in the previous class conditional gradient method. I want to minimize a function f of x. X is in capital X. And the algorithm is xk plus 1 equals to xk plus alpha k x bar k minus xk, and x bar k equals to argmin x in capital X, gradient of fxk transpose x minus xk. Okay, so this was the conditional gradient method. Now, if x is non-stationary, if x is stationary, then this implies that gradient of fx transpose x minus y minus x is greater than or equal to 0 for all y in capital X. Okay, so if x is non-stationary, this is actually a definition of stationary point. So x is stationary. Is the same as saying that the gradient of fx transpose y minus x, so every feasible direction starting at x has to be non-negative. So if x is non-stationary, what does this imply? If x is non-stationary, what would mean for this inner product to be greater than 0, equal to 0, less than 0? What do you think? Greater than 0? So not of, so A, if and only if B, not of A implies not of B, right? So not of B is less than 0. Y minus X is less than 0 for some Y in capital X. Yes?
So you can still find out. If you're on the edge of your convex set,
right,
you have a gradient greater than 0 possible, right?
The gradient, so this is inner product, right? So
will that inner product be greater than 0 if you find a minimum?
If you're at the minimum, then it will be greater than or equal to 0, okay. Right? So that's the first order, the necessary condition for optimality. Okay. So if x is optimal, then x is stationary, okay, which means that holds. So if x is non-stationary, so if you're not, if you're at a non-stationary point, then it means that you will be able to find at least one y such that the inner product of this is strictly less than 0. So if xk was not an optimal point, then it won't be stationary. If it is not an optimal point, then potentially you can find and x bar k such that this particular term is going to be strictly negative. Well, the inner product is going to be strictly negative. Okay, so once you have written down, I'm going to argue it correctly. So I'm still seeing some people are writing it down, so I'll wait for them to finish. And then I'm going to argue, what do I mean to imply here?
What do you mean by stationary?
So remember, in the stationary means it satisfies first order necessary condition for optimality. Okay, so In the case of unconstrained optimization, it is gradient of fx equal to 0. In the case of constrained optimization, it's this condition. Okay. So I know that xk is optimal implies that xk is stationary. Right? So this is something I know from necessary condition for optimality. So if I'm at a non-optimal point, then xk can potentially be non-stationary. If it is non-stationary, then it means that there exists a y in x such that gradient of fx transpose y minus x is strictly less than 0. What that would mean is if I minimize this inner product where x is equal to xk and y is the same as this variable x here, then in that case, I can find a minimum point x bar k such that gradient of fxk transpose x bar k minus xk is strictly less than 0. Okay? And therefore, you will always, if you descend in this particular direction, so if you run this iteration for alpha k positive, but sufficiently small or picked appropriately using Armijo's rule or any of your other favorite rules, then you will always minimize or reduce the value of the function along that direction, and therefore you will get closer to the optimal point or closer to the minimum point. But the only guarantee you get for the limit of the sequence xk is that it has to be a stationary sequence, it has to be a stationary point, which doesn't imply optimality unless the function f is convex. Okay? So in particular, the main result is that if x is compact, if x is closed and bounded, then x bar k minus xk or dk equal to x bar k minus xk is gradient related. To xk. Okay, and because of this gradient relatedness, it would imply that xk would converge to, so if xk converges to x bar, then x bar is stationary. The line of reasoning is similar to what we had for the unconstrained optimization. Okay, we'll pause here for questions. Okay, yeah.
So does that mean that the optimization must converge if it reaches?
So when will an optimization not converge? When your alpha k is not appropriately chosen. Okay, so you can choose alpha k according to some weird fashion, and so your optimization algorithm doesn't converge. So this xk, what does it mean for an algorithm to not converge? Well, this xk is just going all over the place and it's not getting to some point. So if it goes to some limit, which would happen if you pick your alpha k appropriately, so for instance, it has to be diminishing step size or Armijo's alpha k chosen according to Armijo's rule or some such method, then your algorithm will converge. And if your algorithm converges, then what you converge to is a stationary point which satisfies this condition for x replaced with x bar. That would mean that x bar is a candidate for optimal solution, but it's not an optimal solution unless you can use some sort of sufficiency condition to guarantee that it is a local optimal. Okay? So as long as you are at a non-stationary point, you will always find a descent direction. And that idea is essentially used to prove that your direction is gradient related to xk. And so this would directly imply that if xk converges, if your algorithm converges to a point x bar, then x bar must be stationary. Now, of course, in order for algorithm to converge, you want to make sure that your alpha k satisfies some conditions, which is minimization rule, limited minimization rule, or Armijo's rule, or some such method. Okay? Of course, the detailed proof is given in the book, and as I've mentioned in the class, we are not going to go through all the proofs. We are only going to touch some of the most important proofs in the lecture in this class. So if you are interested in understanding the convergence behavior, you should definitely consult the book. Now I want to see pictorially show you what exactly happens when you try to solve this minimization problem. So let's say this is my set X. It's a closed convex set. And my function, so this is my f equals to 0, f equals to 1, f equals to 2, and so on. And you are at this point, your gradient will be in this direction. This will be your gradient. So this is my xk. This is my gradient of fxk. And so if you try and solve this minimization problem, you would realize that this would be the optimal point because it's a linear program. So gradient of fxk is a vector. You are minimizing the inner product of two vectors. So the solution will always be at one of the extreme points for a good reason, but I can't tell you what that reason is. Well, a concave function over a convex set, if you minimize a concave function, so this is a linear function, so it is both concave and convex. If you minimize a concave function over a convex set, the optimal solution will always lie at the boundary. Okay? I can give you a pictorial proof of it. So this is my concave function. This is my convex set. The minimum will be either at this point or at this point. Okay? It can't be in the middle. So a concave function, if you minimize a concave function over a convex set, the optimal solution will always be at the boundary. Okay? So in the case of linear program, the optimal solution will always be at one of these vertices. Okay? So at this particular point, xk, if you try to solve that minimization problem, your x bar k will be this one. So this is your x bar k. And so you will try to descend in this direction. You will get here. At this point, this is your xk plus 1. At this point, your normal is in this direction. And the minimum point, once you solve that, would be this point, x bar k plus 1. And so you will start descending in that direction. And so you will essentially go through a zigzag path, and then you will converge to this optimal solution. Okay, so that's the convergence behavior of conditional gradient method. Okay, so let's recap the what's happening there. So this is a linear program over a convex region. The solution will always be at the boundary. It's also a linear program in this particular case, a linear program over a polygon, in which case the solution will be one of these three vertices, okay, for this linear program. So in the case of this particular vector, it's making the minimum inner product with respect to x bar k minus xk, so with respect to this particular vector. So the solution is going to be, so x bar k is going to be this point, and so you will descend along this direction using an appropriate choice of alpha. Once you reach here, your gradient direction has changed, because of which your new descent direction is going to be x bar k plus 1 minus xk plus 1. So you are going to move in that direction. Next time again, this will be your descent direction, and so you are going to move in this direction, and so on. And in this case, you are going to take a zigzag path in order to reach the optimal point x star. Now, this seems pretty wasteful because you are going through a zigzag path, not some sort of a linear path or a path that directly goes towards x star. And that is indeed a limitation of conditional gradient method. So if you are running conditional gradient method for a non-convex or even non-linear function fx, you will be able to converge to x star, but you will take a long time to converge, okay? Now, based on what we have discussed, based on what the convergence behavior of this particular algorithm is, what do you think would be a case where conditional gradient method will actually perform very well? So under what conditions will conditional gradient method perform very well? Can you think and, yeah? If it's a linear function, you will again have the same problem. Well, for a linear function, I mean, solving this will give you the exact solution, no matter what, right? So it has to be used for a non-convex function. Okay, what's the key problem here? The key problem is you're solving a linear program over a convex region, so your solution will always be at one of these vertices, okay? That's the property of linear program. That's the property of minimizing a linear program over a polygon or a polytope. So the solution will always be at one of these vertices of the polytope. In order to get a descent direction that is going towards x star. So ideally, we would like to get a descent direction which is directly pointing towards x star. That's the only way you can move quickly towards x star. When would that happen? When would you get a descent direction that is going towards x star? So in under two situations, you have some thoughts?
If the corners of the polytope are on the same line,
are on the same line. You are very close, but you're not there yet. Not the same line, because then it won't be a corner. Sorry? Not boundary. Well, corners is always at the boundary. It can never be in the interior of the set. Any other thoughts?
The optimal solution should be on the vertex.
It's always going to be on the vertex, but my question is, when will you get a descent direction that is pointing towards x star? If the two coincide, well, yes, that's true, but that's a very rare incident where such a thing would happen. But you are, any other thoughts? You are very close, but
no corners.
So what will a convex set look like without corners? Something like a sphere, right? Or if you have a lot of corners, you have so many corners that you can pretty much span any of the directions by going through one of those corners, right? So the idea is, well, so this conditional gradient method works very well when your set X has a lot of corners, okay? A lot of corners in all directions. So typically a sphere has, I mean, all the points at the boundary are corners essentially because they are extreme points of the set. So conditional gradient method works well. When X has a lot, no, lot of corners slash sphere, looks spherical, or has positive curvature, at the boundary. Okay, so let's see why that would be the case for the exact same example. So I have like too many corners here. Okay, these are all linear regions, okay, but I have just too many corners. This is my X star. A function would look something like this. And so no matter where I am, there will always be one corner which is close to X star, and therefore you would always be pointing very in a direction that is moving you towards X star and not in a zigzag fashion, in a less zigzag fashion. So you're getting closer to X star with every step. Okay? So for that, you need a lot of corners and you want X star to be close to one of those corners. In which case, conditional gradient method will work very well. Yes?
I was just confused, how did we define xk bar?
Xk bar is defined here. So a point that minimizes the inner product between the gradient and x bar k minus xk. So in this, so remember, when will the minimum happen? Well, the gradient of fxk has to make an obtuse angle with x minus xk, right? So if you look at this particular figure, it makes very small angle with this point. It makes perhaps 90 degree or close to 90 degree with respect to that point, but it makes maximum angle with respect to this point. Therefore, this is the descent direction. Omar, you had a question?
Yeah, what does that positive curvature mean?
It is the same thing as convex, but so if you are in this region, then your boundary has a positive curvature. But if you are in this region, then your boundary doesn't have positive curvature. It has a negative curvature.
So you just want a convex set.
Well, we are always doing convex set in this case. So X is convex by definition in this set. In this situation, right?
Okay, so it's always going to have positive curvature.
Well, look at this case, okay? It doesn't have positive curvature here.
Oh, okay.
Okay? So, yeah.
So, why does it have to be in the corner? Why can't it be along that line at the bottom?
Because that's the property of linear program. It's a concave function over a convex region. So, the solution is always going to be at one of the extreme points. Okay, so the extreme points of a set like this are these vertices, but for a sphere, the extreme points are this entire boundary of the set itself. Yes?
So is the whole point of this just to make sure you're not overshooting the bounded region? Is that?
Yes, the whole point of this is you're not overshooting the boundary. Yeah. There was another question.
So, can we solve this extreme zigzag motion by giving a little bit of weightage to the past directions?
That's called momentum method, and that's a very well studied method in the context of unconstrained optimization. I haven't seen the use in the context of conditional gradient method, which is not to say that nobody has proposed it before, I just haven't seen it. Perhaps somebody would have proposed it. But if not, then you have a good problem to work on. I think that's a good idea. That's called momentum. look up this heavy ball method. Okay, that's exactly what heavy ball method attempts to do, and I think it's a good idea to try it for this method. Any other question? Okay. All right, so it works well when X has a lot of corners or has a positive curvature at the boundary. Okay, so in this case, the boundary doesn't have positive curvature. In this case, the boundary doesn't have positive curvature, but it looks like a positive curvature because there are just so many extreme points that connects along the boundary. And of course, if it is a sphere, then it automatically has positive curvature. And this method will work very well for optimization over spheres or optimization over a set with lots of inequality constraints.
In this kind of set, we start from a point inside that convex set.
Right.
And the obtuse angle in the first iteration is higher. So that means this method has a huge jump.
Right. I can't say really jump will be huge because that depends on how you pick your alpha k. Right. So if your alpha k is small, it won't be a huge jump. If your alpha k is large, it will be a huge jump.
So you can change alpha k between iterations.
Of course, yeah. So alpha k is a function of k, so you can change it from one k to another. Yes.
Does the region where you need the concavity, curvature, convexity, depend upon where you start the optimization?
Well, it always, because if you are close to X star by stroke of luck, then...
if you're close, then it's kind of obvious. But even if you're far away, but that particular sort of region has...
positive curvature or looks like positive curvature, then you will descend towards X star pretty quickly. Yeah. Okay. So we had discussed two ideas. So now let's go ahead and talk about the next method. So we had discussed two ideas for solving problems of this type. One was we look at a feasible direction so that it's a descent direction. So this is that method where you pick a feasible direction according to this fashion, and then you're guaranteed to be in a descent direction if you're taking a step in the descent direction. But the other idea was, if you go out of the set, you project it back onto the set, right? And then you have one algorithm like that. So we are going to study that algorithm, and that is called gradient projection method. Gradient projection method. So we were and the idea is again, this is be our iteration, but your x bar k will be xk minus sk gradient of fxk projected onto the set capital X. So this algorithm, this part of the algorithm remains the same. The only thing I've changed is the method to pick X bar K, where I pick X bar K in this fashion. So what is happening? Let's say this is my convex set. Here I stand at XK, and I look at, this is XK minus SK gradient of FXK, and I come to this particular point. Okay. Now I am going to project this particular point back onto the set. So let me project it here, and this is my x bar k. This point is my x bar k, and now I'm going to take a step in this direction. So this will be my xk plus 1. Yes?
Why don't you just project or just step into x bar k?
You can do that. That would be alpha k equals 1 all the time. That's a constant step size algorithm. Yeah. Okay. So this is the second method where I don't have to solve an optimization problem, but I do have to project the point onto a set. And the idea is pretty simple. I do the usual steepest descent. So this is the usual steepest descent method. I do the usual steepest descent, get to this point, then I project it onto the set, I get x bar k, and then I descend along the direction x bar k minus xk. Okay, so somewhere in the middle, I'll have xk plus 1. Of course, you can always pick alpha k equals to 1, in which case you will be, xk plus 1 will be equal to x bar k. So I'll write it here. Alpha k equals to 1 implies xk plus 1 equals to x bar k. Yeah.
So in this case, that the optimum solution is not on the boundary of the
right.
And if you take alpha k as 1, does that mean we never converge to the exact optimum solution? Because
no, because here you have two parameters to play with, sk and alpha k. So I have to tell you how to pick xk. Sk. Okay. But even if your solution is inside, you will go along the boundary, and then at some point of time, you will go inside the set, and then you will do the usual gradient descent inside the set, because the projection of a point inside the set is the point itself, right? And then it'll boil down to the usual gradient descent, and then you will get to your x star. Okay. All right. So as I mentioned earlier, we have two parameters to play with, alpha k and sk. So let's see how to pick sk and alpha k in this problem. We could pick sk equals to constant, alpha k equals to alpha k according to minimization rule. You can pick sk equals to constant, alpha k according to Armijo's rule. You can pick sk equals to 1 over k, diminishing step size. Alpha k equals to constant, perhaps equal to 1. Okay. And the fourth method is sk is picked according to Armijo's rule along projection arc, and alpha k equals to 1. Okay. Okay, I understand this easy. I understand this as well. So I pick alpha k according to Armijo's rule. Sk is constant. I understand this. Fine. Sk is diminishing step size. Alpha k equals to 1. I understand this method as well. But the fourth method is something that I don't understand. What is Armijo's rule along projection arc? Okay, so let's try and understand what this method of picking Sk is. Anyone remembers what the idea of Armijo's rule was? Well, you have to remember because it's part of your assignment. But I don't know if anyone remembers right now what the idea of Armijo's rule was. Someone who hasn't spoken in the class until now can potentially tell me what the idea of Armijo's rule was. Anyone remembers? Yes.
So I don't remember all the details, but
yeah.
It's basically a way to choose your step size. You check if a step size is good. And
right.
If it is good, you use that. And if not, you change it until it is good.
Perfect. That's a one-line answer for what Armijo's rule is. So you iteratively pick the step size. Okay. So you start with a very big step size, see whether that step size is good according to certain criteria or not. If it is not good, you multiply it by a constant factor, sort of reduce it by a constant factor, and then you check whether that step size is good or not. If it is not good, then you reduce it and so on until you find a good step size. So that was for picking alpha k, right? That was the Armijo's rule. Now let's see what happens when we try the same thing for picking Sk when alpha k is equal to 1. So let me define x bar k s equals to xk minus s projection of xk minus s gradient of fxk. And then I'm going to pick m naught such that, no, I'm going to pick sk equals to s bar beta raised to m naught, where m naught is the minimum natural number that satisfies f of xk minus f of x bar k s bar beta raised to m. I shouldn't write x bar k, or maybe I should write x bar k. That's fine. So this difference has to be greater than equal to sigma gradient transpose xk minus x bar k s beta raised to m. Okay, so that's the criteria for figuring out whether a particular value of sk is good or not. Okay, yes.
Shouldn't we put a minus sign like the regular Armijo's rule before sigma? On the right hand side?
I think that there should be a negative sign. Let me check with the book. I think you are correct. There has to be a negative sign, which I... The book doesn't have a negative sign, but I think you are right. Let me check the original Armijo's rule. You know, so the book doesn't have a negative sign, but I am, okay, so the book has negative sign in the original Ermihoz rule, where Ermihoz rule was introduced for alpha k, but it doesn't have a negative sign when it introduces the Ermihoz rule for sk, and I think there has to be a negative sign, so I have to inform the author or clarify with him whether it's a mistake or I am not able to understand this well. I think there has to be a negative sign, okay? But I'm not sure. I'll write the disclaimer here, not in the book. That's a good catch. Do you want to write an email to Professor Bertsikas and ask him? No? Okay. Okay, then I'll have to do it. All right. Okay, so what is this method trying to do? Let's again see pictorially. So I have this set X. I'm at a boundary. Okay, well, if I'm not at the boundary, then this is just the regular Ermihoz rule, because your projection, you're not doing projection at all if you're not at the boundary. So let's assume that you are at the boundary or close to boundary, and this is your xk. This is your first attempt. This is your xk minus s bar gradient of fxk. You're going to project it onto the set x bar k s bar, and you're going to check whether this is good step size or not, whether the function value has reduced by a significant amount or not. If it hasn't, if the function value at this point is not significantly lower than the function value at this point, you are going to reduce the step size. So this is your xk minus s bar beta gradient of fxk. And then you're going to project it, and you get x bar k s bar beta, this point. Again, you are going to go through that condition and check whether the function value has reduced significantly or not. And if not, you will do the same thing and let's say at this point the function value has reduced significantly, then this will be your xk plus 1. Okay, that's because your alpha k is equal to 1 in this case. Okay. All right. So in the gradient projection method, the idea is you can pick SK according to certain fashion, you can pick alpha K according to certain fashion. And then you have this iteration. This requires projection, so the projection onto the set has to be an easy operation for you to be able to use this method. And if projection is easy, then you can apply any of these techniques to run your gradient descent method for optimization over convex set. The only issue with Ermihoz rule along projection arc is that you have to do a lot of function evaluations and you have to do a lot of projection. So the problem better have certain structure which you can exploit in order to make sure that this computation is pretty fast. But if your problem doesn't have that structure, if the projection is difficult, if the function evaluation is difficult, then you may not want to use a gradient projection method, or you may not want to use Armijo's rule for this class of problems. Yeah?
When is the function evaluation difficult?
So when is the function evaluation difficult? So suppose your function has, like if your x is 1 million dimensional, then you could have problems in evaluating the function. The other case, which is pretty common in machine learning, is that your data is distributed over many servers. Then you have to get all the data onto one server and then evaluate the function. That may not be feasible or may have a lot of delays, and therefore you may not want to do function evaluation. Okay. I don't think in the earlier days function evaluation was a big challenge, but nowadays function evaluation has become problematic in many situations. Okay. Any other question? Okay. Now you can have a Newton's version of the gradient projection method, not the gradient projection method, but the other conditional gradient method. So if there are no more questions, I'm going to erase this and we are going to talk about the Newton's method pretty quickly. Okay. Let's talk about constrained Newton's method, where I'm going to compute x bar k by solving and then you update according to the usual fashion. And you can pick, of course, sk equals to 1, alpha k equals to 1 when you are close to x star. Okay. Now this idea was also alluded to in the previous class. I don't know if Mubarak, you had said you can use a second derivative to rotate the vector. So you don't exactly use the second derivative to rotate the vector, but you do something similar, which is by solving a second order minimization problem in order to compute the descent direction, which amounts to doing the same thing, but in a more sophisticated manner. Okay? So this method is known as constrained Newton's method. Of course, you have to solve a quadratic programming problem over a convex set. So I don't know how difficult or easy it's going to be, depending upon the convex set you have. So if the convex set is given by a polytope or a simplex, then quadratic programming is somewhat easier, and you can perhaps solve it to get the superlinear convergence rate due to the Newton's method. But if not, if x is spherical or some other kind of weird convex set, then of course solving this problem would become a big challenge, and you may not want to use constrained Newton's method at all. In which case, your convergence is not going to be as fast as Newton's method guarantees. You will be left with either the conditional gradient method or gradient projection method to solve your optimization problem. Okay, so that's constrained Newton's method. So we introduced three algorithms in today's class. Conditional gradient was introduced in the previous class, but we studied three algorithms back to back for solving problems of this type, okay? And each of them have certain characteristics which makes them amenable to implementation in real world problems. So in the case of conditional gradient method, the first method we studied, you need to have positive curvature in order to get good convergence guarantee, or at least to be able to converge quickly. In the case of gradient projection method, you need to be able to project a point outside the set to a point into the set easily. If that takes a lot of computation, then gradient projection method is not good, not useful for your problem. And then the third method we have talked about is constrained Newton's method, where you solve a quadratic programming problem and get quick convergence to the optimal solution because Newton's method is much faster than other methods, other gradient methods that we have talked about. In the next class, I'm going to talk about a very important class of algorithms called manifold suboptimization method, which requires, let me just write it here, which requires X to be of this type, AX less than equal to B, okay? So for problems of this type, we have what is known as a manifold suboptimization method, okay? We'll talk about this method in the next class. It is also known as simplex method in the context of linear programming, okay? But that idea is more general and can be applied to nonlinear functions as well. And for that case, it's called manifold suboptimization method, which is what we are going to study in the next class. So we are going to spend two classes discussing this manifold suboptimization method. And then we'll talk about affine scaling method as well.
Which cases will be this constrained Newton's method more efficient than the other two?
Yes, it will be, but...
At which cases?
When is Newton's method... when does Newton's method give you superlinear convergence rate? Well, when you are very close to X star. Now, how close? That depends on what the curvature of the function is and what the nature of your optimization is. So you get the same benefit in this case. You can pick SK to be small when you are far away from X star. And then as you move into the simulation and you get closer and closer to X star, you can pick SK equals to 1 and alpha K equals to 1, and then you will get superlinear convergence rate. I don't know if that answers your question, but.
And when is it going to diverge or when it will be not useful?
So this is a quadratic programming problem, right? You have D transpose second derivative D plus some vector transpose direction D, right? So you want to be able to compute this quadratic program efficiently in order for you to be able to use this method, right? Now, depending upon the nature of this set, it may be easy to solve this quadratic programming or it may be difficult. A priori, it's not easy for me to say in which case it's going to be easy to solve this quadratic program. What we do know is that solving quadratic program of this type over set AX less than equal to B or AX equal to B is pretty straightforward. okay? But for other cases, I don't know how difficult or easy it's going to be to solve this problem. All right, so we'll all meet in the next class and talk about manifold suboptimization method.